Good afternoon or good morning, everybody. Welcome to today's webinar on working with your black and white images in Capture One. If this is your first webinar and you don't know who you're listening to, my name's David. I'm part of the Capture One sales team based out of Copenhagen in Denmark. So we have a 60-minute session today. We will probably use most of that, I would think, although it is a relatively easy concept to grasp, but there's not only the black and white tool that we can talk about, but also tools related to that which help with your black and white workflow. So we do have that 60-minute session. You are very welcome and encouraged to ask questions throughout. If you look at the bottom of your GoToWebinar control panel, if you're on your Mac or PC, you'll see a panel called Questions. Put a question in there that will come straight through to me. If you're on your Android device or iOS device, there's a question mark icon at the bottom. Tap that, and again, you can put a question straight through to me. There is quite a lot of you, so if you could try to keep your questions on topic, that's an enormous benefit not only to me but also for everyone else who are listening who are interested in today's subject as well. I am recording this session too, so you can catch up with it again on our YouTube channel should you wish to refresh any of your memory on it. So let's move over to Capture One, if you just bear with me a moment. So we should be seeing Capture One on screen just about now, I would guess. And to help you locate the mouse, you may see it highlighted like so from time to time. Before we start, I'm just going to put up on screen a small poll. If you've joined a webinar before, you would have seen it. Just what is your current RAW converter? It just helps me to potentially shape the content a little bit depending on your answers. Thank you for those who already upgraded to Capture One Pro 9. For those of you who are on earlier versions, there's a couple of things you'll see today that are not in version 8 and earlier, which work particularly nicely with black and white. And for those of you on Aperture and Lightroom, hopefully we can show you something to inspire you as well. Okay, thanks for answering. I can see that most of you are awake, so that's always a good start. Right. So first of all, what we do is we look at the basic black and white tool and how that works. Then maybe slightly strangely, we can have a look at the color editor, because that can have an influence in how we work with our images, our black and white conversions. We're also going to look at some local adjustments. We're also going to look at the color balance tool, which may sound a bit strange in relation to black and white, but we can do some nice stuff with that. And we'll also briefly cover working with presets as well. Just something you might like to do. I'm not on the standard workspace, but you will find the black and white tool, maybe slightly strangely, lives in the color tool tab. If you want to, and if you're doing black and white conversions a lot, if you right click up here and say add tool tab, we did actually design a specific black and white tool tab which kind of adds in some of the tools that you're probably going to want to use for working with black and white. So I'd probably just rearrange this slightly. I probably wouldn't extensively use levels at this point. I definitely use curves, definitely use exposure, clarity, vignetting, and film grain. So adding the black and white tool tab actually can be quite handy, and also the styles and presets. Excuse me. So first of all, let's look at the black and white tool in its basics and how it actually works. When we look at some image examples, the first thing that I'll say is that it makes sense to do some basic adjustments on the color image before actually moving to black and white. So just hold that thought for the minute, and then we will look at that in more detail with the image examples. But let's just concentrate now on how the tool works as such. If you're not seeing my workspace, hopefully you are. If the screen's frozen, just jump out the webinar and jump back in again, but hopefully you're actually seeing Capture One on screen now, as far as I can tell. Just give me a heads up if you can't see the nice image I have here of the Chinese girl, etc. Okay, So black and white tool, as I said, if we check the box here, very simply, enable black and white, then you see instantly the image goes to black and white, which as you would expect. Now you have a number of sliders here, which essentially allow you to change the density of the various different color tones in the image. So red, yellow, green, cyan, blue, magenta. Dragging the slider to the left, let's just take red for example, you can see the red tones get darker in the background. Drag it to the right, they will get lighter. So this allows you to balance the various densities of an image just by dragging the slider. And I would say the very non-scientific way of doing it, which is exactly what I do, is just to grab each of the sliders in turn and just see the effect that they have on the image. So we can guess that this is a pair of blue shorts. So as we grab the blue slider, then we can change the density as you see. So you can balance your black and white image by using those various sliders. If I just reset that, it's somewhat different to simply going negative saturation, because you don't get the ability to balance the density of all the colors in the image itself. So always try to use the black and white tool to do so. So again, enable black and white, decide on the densities by pulling the various different sliders to balance your image. So that's the most basic way to make your black and white conversion. If you're happy with that, then you can stop right there and you can leave the webinar. But there's a lot more stuff we can do, as I said, with the color editor, local adjustments. We've got film grain to look at, the color balance tool, presets, and so on. So all kinds of different stuff to look at. If I reset once more and go to split tones, we can do quite nice split toning too. So if we turn on enable black and white once more, you have highlights and shadows separately and a slider for each hue and saturation. So very simply, we need to pick the hue that we would like to have for highlights. So let's just go for a warmish tone. And then you see as I move the slider, note how the color changes of the saturation slider below. So that's indicating the tone that we're going to have in our highlights. So now if I drag saturation up, you can see what's happening until it looks really super, super ugly, but just in the highlights, of course. So we can balance that as we wish. And then shadows as such. Again, if we go to change the hue and then drag up the saturation, we can do very simple split toning like so. Of course, if you wanted the same tone over the whole image, you would just equalize your sliders roughly in the same place, and then you could tone as you wished, for example. So you can split tone, and then as I said later on, using the color balance tool, we can actually triple tone as well, or give a slightly different effect to a standard black and white split tone. So let's just reset that once more. Whoops, wrong button. Let's say reset like so. There are some presets here, like so. You can see just by clicking here. So if you wanted like red yellow filter, for example, you could see various different versions there. And then just by clicking down the various different options, like so, then you can see exactly how the preset's going to look. So that's sometimes can be good starting points. If you think, oh, I like the look of that yellow blue toning. If we look at split tones, if we look at split tone like so, we can see yellow blue, exactly what's happened. But if you think, well, I'd like just to have a little bit more yellow in it, there's nothing to stop you editing the preset thereafter. So it is entirely possible to take a preset from here. So let's say red, yellow, for example, and then think, well, I'd just like it to be a little bit stronger. But the presets can be a good way to do it. Could you create keyboard commands for each slider? You could, like, well, not necessarily a keyboard command. You could use the cursor keys. So if I just use the up cursor key and then tab through, then we can use the cursor keys like so. But it's quite a big range, so it's not like by moving it a tiny amount that you're going to see a huge change in the image. So I think by using sliders, especially if you exaggerate your movements and get smaller and smaller, then it helps to adjust well. Remember on the webinar broadcast, it's not going to be as fluid as you're seeing here. I think you only get 7 or 8 frames per second as such, not the sort of the full frame rate that Capture One is delivering, for example. So really, that's the basic use of the tools. Enable the tool, decide on the density of the colors, or use split toning. You can try to do some, or you can use some of the presets first of all, like so, which you can then decide, okay, I might like to just edit that a little bit more myself, for example. So pretty simple to use in that respect, but applying this in the practical sense, we can actually go a bit further. So let's stick with this image. I'm pretty sure this is how, if we just reset, that's how it came out of camera. It's not my image, it's from another photographer, and that was their final chosen result. So you can see if we just bring up both images together, darkened off the backgrounds a little bit, and then just given a little bit more, what's the word, focus on the subject, probably by the UCS, by a bunch of local adjustments like so. So you can see this particular local adjustment has just turned down the background highlights a bit, brightened up the skin tones here. And then, for example, we just brightened up the bottom of the dress. Subtle, but certainly makes a big difference to the image. So as I said at the start, it makes sense to try to start with a good color version before you go into your black and white version. We might find that when we do the black and white transformation that perhaps it's too dark in the background or we need to soften the contrast a bit. But anyway, start with your good color version. And then a good bit of advice is to say clone variant. So this will give us a virtual copy of the image. Doesn't copy the raw file, just basically creates another preview for you to then work on. So we've got exactly the same image, as you can see, and now this is, gives me a good basis to make my black and white conversion. Because let's say we start converting this to black and white, and then, you know what, we've gone too far or it's not working out how we wanted to, we could just delete that and then clone this one again and start from scratch. So we've got our nice color. So first of all, let's go to our newly added black and white tool tab, enable black and whites, and have a look what's going on. So I would argue maybe it's a little bit dark, slightly too dark in the background. What were those shorts? They were blue, weren't they? Or were those red shorts? I can't remember. So again, we do my sort of non-scientific process of just balancing that. We could argue that maybe it's that local adjustment is just maybe a little bit too aggressive. So we could just brighten that up a little bit. Back to the black and white tool. Really, probably at this point. So you can see the blue is just picking up the blue in her dress. But we don't want to go too bright because that just looks odd. And then magenta, a little bit going on in the background, but not much. So at this point, pretty happy with that black and white conversion. I might, in this case, skin tones. That's just the local adjustment controlling the girl itself. So we could just lighten that a tiny bit more. And I think what I would do is just experiment with the contrast overall. So I'd probably just soften off the contrast a little bit myself. So even though we started with a good color point, it might make sense to adjust a few of the parameters that look good for the color, but maybe not as suitable for the color version. Could I leave the color image beside it? Terence is asking. Yeah, let's have a look. So if we bring up the, that was our color. Let's just hide the browser, hide the tools, and then we can see the difference like so. Again, maybe let's just bring back that local adjustment, skin tones. Maybe that's not a bad tip, Terence, is to have always assess the color alongside it as well. But I think that looks pretty good. So that's an easy one, really. There isn't much we had to do to that image to, I think, get a good basic black and white conversion. Let's have another look at the, let's go for a slightly different image. This one again. Let's find, that's how it was out of camera. These are actually from XF100. So we've got bags of resolution to play with in this respect. So that's out of camera. That's just with a little bit of adjustment. drop saturation and cleaning up some marks on the background and so on. But again, that gives us a good point to start our black and white. So I'll do the same thing again. Let's say clone variant. So that gives me number 4 here. Might as well hide our browser. Command B. We'll bring up the color image again. Don't worry, Terence. And start the same process once more. Oh, just so you know, for the local adjustments, that, as I said, there's just two heel layers which were getting rid of some marks in the background, but nothing else in particular going on local adjustment wise. So enable black and white, away we go. So in this case, probably, let's just reset that, enable black and white. Skin tone wise, I would guess if we pulled up the red channel, we're probably going to exaggerate that, brighten or darken her skin. So just be aware of that, because there is obviously a fair amount of red in skin tone, probably a little bit of yellow as well. Yeah, so if we bring up red and yellow, we can see that. So we could lighten it a bit, but it's not affecting the shirt so much. So that gives us quite nice control over the skin tone as such, hopefully without losing any detail. Let's just zoom in as such. So that's actually looking pretty nice. We're not losing any skin detail or anything like that. What was our background? That was a blue, I think, wasn't it? So we could just use that to dial the background down a little bit. And like I said before, when we're dealing with contrast, there's a couple of different ways you could approach this. The contrast slider in Capture One 9 is pretty much like the Luma curve. So when you adjust contrast in Capture One 9, what you're actually doing is adjusting contrast but preserving the saturation levels as they were before and not shifting the hue. And you might say, well, why is that important for a black and white image? Maybe just to digress a little bit in case you haven't seen this or aware of this, let's just reset this. If we were to adjust contrast with an RGB curve, or indeed the slider how it used to work on Capture One 8, I'd do something fairly aggressive. You can see my blue sky if we just temporarily reset that. So that's before and after. So our blue has got much more saturated, the blue on the tower is more saturated, and so on. If we do the same with a Luma curve, again, let's just do it fairly saturated. You can see whilst our contrast has gone up, so before, after, the color and hue is largely unchanged. So we don't want color shifts or hue shifts, because that might actually affect our black and white conversion as such. So if you do want to play with contrast, I mean, in this case, we could decide, do we want softer contrast or depends on what you're going for, really. I'd probably err on the side of flatter. Then we could use our contrast slider. Don't be feel guilty about using a slider. That's no bad thing. Or, of course, if you want to use the curves tool to adjust contrast, then that's going to give you a little bit more precision as such as well. But to be honest, the contrast slider does a really nice job of giving you either a good increase or a good decrease without having to futz about with a curve or stuff or as such. So I'd probably leave that as is. Shirt wise, if we're worried that we've lost a bit of highlight detail, we can always bring it back with our HDR slider as well. So again, even though we started with the color, it does sometimes make sense to tweak a little bit for the black and white conversion. We'll come back to this one, because when we talk about dodging and burning, we can actually do a little bit to the face as well, which I'm no expert at, but I'll give you some idea if you are an expert how you can do a better job than me, for example, on that. Mara says, could you add black and white filters, yellow, orange, red filter, conserving the ability to adjust colors and exposure? Sort of yes and no, I suppose. I guess in the traditional sense, we're not doing quite the same thing as a red filter would have done, because that would block the spectrum, of course. So it is slightly different. I don't think we've got any presets that particularly do that as such. So you can't necessarily mimic exactly that. But I think Remember, you're working on a digital file. It's not exactly the same as placing a filter in front of the lens and shooting film as such. So you have to work with the tools you have in this respect. So I think it's, personally, I think it's all about creating a black and white that looks nice, not necessarily following something that, oh, perhaps I did this in the past with the yellow filter. Like if you wanted to darken off a blue sky, I mean, I haven't shot black and white film for a long time, but you would use what, yellow filters or red filters, where in this case, if we wanted a more dramatic blue sky, we could drop down our blue filter and do another trick, which we'll look at in a minute as well, but we'll come back to that. So as I said, I think this one is about finish. We could always throw in a little bit of vignetting if we felt that fitted this image better. Maybe it doesn't, or go the other way. So there we go. Yeah, it's a good idea to have presets as a launch pad. I think that's a good way to treat them, because you might find, and let's think about saving this preset. So we're really happy with this black and white look that I've somewhat created. So how would I save this as a preset to use elsewhere? So you'll see in our black and white tool tab, we can actually save a style. Now, just to give you two distinct differences, you have presets and styles in Capture One. A preset is from a single tool only, so we could save our black and white settings. So that's a preset. So every tool you can save a preset, for example. A style is, if you like, a collection of presets. So a style is the saving of all the current settings on the tools. So we can say, okay, this is a really nice black and white look. I'm happy with that. So I'm going to save this as a style. So I'm going to save user style. Now you immediately get shown a menu, which is what contains all the things in your style. Now, it might not make sense to have exposure, because that could be specific to the image, so you can uncheck that. It might not make sense to have contrast, but let's say the contrast adjustment was part of your style. Again, the same goes for brightness, saturation, highlight recovery. Was that an intentional part of the style, or was that a correction on the image? We could say our curve was part of that. We probably don't want to have white balance. We probably don't want to have the skin tone edits. We do want to have black and white enabled. Maybe the lens correction stuff is specific to that. Vignetting, that could be part of it. We probably don't want the crop or the rotation. Sharpening and stuff, that's probably, again, could be either unique to the image or not. We probably don't want the various metadata, copyright, and so on. So you just need to think, well, what part of the style could be universally applied to other images? So now I've decided what makes up good components of the style. We can say save, and we call this, and you will get a tip, actually, spot removal. That's a good point. So let's save that style. Spot removal, where was it? In details. Yeah, spot removal is obviously unique. Again, rating color tag. Just missed that one. Exposure contrast, highlight recovery. I'll take exposure off. We'll leave our curve. White balance, we won't worry about that. We definitely want black and white, and so on. So you get the idea. So let's call this my black and, whoops, can't type, my black and white portrait style. How's that for a long title? Save. So let's go to another image. Let's grab this lady. Go to our styles and presets, built-in styles. Let's see, user styles, my black and white portrait style. Boom. Doesn't look quite so good on this image. So even though a collection of adjustments might look good on one image, doesn't necessarily mean it's going to look great on other images. So as, who was that, Pat said, using a preset as a launch pad for further adjustment is probably a good way to look at it. It might not be perfect on every single image. To remove that, I just need to say remove, and then we're back, like so. So I don't use styles a lot. As I said, I think as Pat suggested, they're a good launch pad, but they're not necessarily the magic bullet to make your images great. So that's why I pretend to prefer to have a good color image, enable my black and white settings, and then go from there, because every image is different really in that respect. Let's have a look. Will we demonstrate a black and white adjustment with the sky? Yes, and you're going to see that for sure. Okay. How do we show before and after when making adjustments? That's a good one. So if you want to preview, let's just mess with some sliders for a minute. This is the reset button right here. So if we click that, that resets the tool. If we just mess with some sliders again, if you option click, so hold your Alt key down like so, and then click and hold, that shows you before. So that's everything at zero and then adjusted. Everything at zero and then adjusted. Okay, we're going to stick with this image because there's quite a good lesson to be learned in this one. So yeah, this is our nicely adjusted color version. It doesn't have any local adjustments, but it does have a color edit, I think, if I remember correctly. It does have a color edit on the background. So it's just darkening the background off a little bit, which might work for our black and white conversion or it might not. So let's have a look. So again, black and white tool tab, enable black and white. Doesn't look too bad out of the box. If we drag blue, that's pretty much going to effect with our background. But if you have a look, there's a little tiny highlight along her shoulder, just where the blue's bleeding into the color on the sweater. So in this case, it actually doesn't make sense to have our color edit. If we turn that off and then we go to our black and white tool tab and actually just use the slider, the blue slider, to vary our density, then that actually does a better job, and then we avoid that sort of halo that we were seeing a little bit on the background. Again, if we probably grab red, you can see red, we're just adjusting a sweater somewhat, but it's also affecting the skin tone, which we might not necessarily want. So if we did want to change the density of the sweater, now we could take our color editor, click on our sweater, and let's just say we wanted to brighten that up a bit. Whoa, too much. So we're much more isolated now on the sweater than we were before. So if we just want to brighten that up a little tiny bit, then we could. So don't forget, the color editor isn't the stupid thing to use with adjusting an image, because we can be much more specific about the color tone. Don't forget, in the color editor, we can really define exactly what color zone that we want to adjust. So we could really restrict it down to a sweater, which wouldn't include her skin tone and so on. So the color editor could be a good thing to use adjusting black and white images as well. So don't forget to use that basically. And again, that's not doing too bad for a black and white adjustment without really much playing around with it at all. If we go to our curve again, or just use the contrast slider in the exposure tool, we could think, do we want it a little bit softer? Just probably than it was compared to the color version, of course. Philip saying, in the process tab, will these black and white conversions be saved as a black and white file, or will it be RGB? Will actually be saved as RGB file. So for example, TIFF, like so. So it's not a grayscale file, it's saved as an RGB file, not a grayscale file. Given the high quality of the raw converter, could you give some indication why the achromatic back could be of value or yield to a superior result? Well, remember, the achromatic back doesn't have any Bayer mosaic, no Bayer interpolation. So you're getting true pixel values for every single pixel. So don't forget, in an image like this, two-thirds of the image is actually guesswork, very clever guesswork, but two-thirds are. Whereas in a pure achromatic back, it's just simple pixel values for every single pixel. But I would say as megapixel counts get higher, then it's probably the gap is narrowing between the benefit of an achromatic back and so on. But you can also, if you think with the achromatic back, special versions without IR filters for infrared photography and so on. So there are advantages, and the quality is that little bit better, of course. But as you can see with the XF100, there's not much to argue about. And I think this is also at ISO. It's such a good sensor, ISO 800 as well. So it's a lovely file quality, even at ISO 800. Will I be working with any monochrome images from the Leica monochrome? Not only with color conversions as such. I mean, the principles really are not going to be much different. I would say with something like the Leica monochrome, again, you want to equalize exposure, get that looking nice. And then really what you're down to working with is curves and local adjustments, which we come to soon. Would the color editor work in a similar way via adjustments layer? Yes, it would. So in this case, if let's say the sweater color was too much of a crossover with her skin tone, there wouldn't be anything to stop you, say, making a local adjustments layer, sweater, and then if we got our brush and grabbed, just I'm going to do this quick and dirty as such, we could draw a mask, blah, 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 avoid her skin tone. As I said, you would spend a little bit more time doing it than I would, like so. And now if we were to pick with our color editor on our sweater as such, like so, oh, Wacom's just having a little bit of a moment. One second, guys. Had a few Wacom driver issues of late. So I'm just going to unplug the Wacom and plug it back in again, see if that helps. Let's see, sweater and color editor. Okay, that's better. Thank you, Pen. So now we can click in the sweater itself, and then we get our color adjustment, just to remember, in the local, let's just open up color editor so you can see it. Close down some of these, like so. Yeah, so now with my very sort of badly drawn mask, we're only just going to be working on the sweater. And then let's say if I just bring up the lightness, for example, then we could brighten up the sweater itself without affecting our skin tones and so on. So yes, Russell, the very long answer to your question is yes, you could use a local adjustment just on a black and white image like so for exactly the same effect. Good question about printing. 30th of March, if you're interested in now printing black and white, then there's going to be an expert joining me. Who's going to talk specifically about printing black and white directly from Capture One. So check out the follow-up email with the webinar program as such, and I'll actually put the exact sign-up link in there so you can come back to see that specifically about printing. Russell says, oh, the most recent Wacom driver advice to uninstall. Okay, I shall do that in that case. All right, so let's have another look at an example where we can combine some local adjustments as well. So let's go to this image. I'm going to reset everything. So we're back to the color version. And then we can do some stuff with the color editor and local adjustments and dodging and burning. So we're going to spend a bit more time on this image. And then we'll also be able to look at grain tool as well. Oh, just to ask, Ross says, how does the view selector color range work with black and white? Well, you won't see it. So if you wanted to see a selected color range, let's just get rid of this local adjustment for a minute. Let's turn off black and white. So if you're not sure what Ross is talking about, if we select a color with our color editor, for example, so if I were to select a sweater like so, if we turn on view selected color range, everything goes to monochrome, which isn't part of the selection, although saying that, like so. So view selected color range. So if we turn on view selected color range, everything goes to monochrome, which isn't part of that selection. So if you do want to narrow down a color range, like you can see in this case, it's affected some of her face. If you do want to narrow down a color range, then that's something I would suggest you do while the image is still in color, before you actually then start to do the black and white conversion, because otherwise you won't really see any difference whatsoever if you're working on the black and white image. So, okay, so this one we can do some work with Sky, who was asking about that. I can't remember. But we are going to look at adjusting the skies as such. So this image, let's just reset that. Everything is on default. So as I said, we might do some normal stuff to the image first of all, but exposure, maybe we just lift it a little tiny bit. We might bring some highlights back. Midtone wise, we could probably just bring the midtones down a bit. We could add some clarity, but I might leave that to the end. Yeah, I tend to leave clarity out of the black and white adjustments and until the end. Sometimes we don't really need it with all the other tools that are going on as well. So I want this to be a really nice black and white. We spoke about Sky bringing out some extra drama and stuff from that. Now, I could, of course, just go to my curves, grab a Luma curve, and then decide, okay, that looks good for the sky, but I've totally killed all the detail in the building and so on. So I actually want to make that operation on the sky only. Now, in the past with Capture One, you would have had to do a bit of auto masking around all those buildings, or use the color editor and so on. So it would have been a bit tricky, but now we can use the color editor. So if I just pick on my blue sky, again, if we say view selected color range, like, see, you see, if I turn that on, you see that building drops to black and white. So that's not part of the color range. I'm not going to really bother refining it anymore because I know I've isolated the sky at least away from this building, at least away from this building. There's a little bit of blue tone in here, which is going to be picked up, but it's probably not going to matter. So we've got a very handy new feature where we can say, create mask layer from selection. So this color selection will be transformed into a mask layer. So it's going to create my mask. If we go to my local adjustments tab and I press M on my keyboard, you can see the mask that we've created, like so. So it's going to edge itself really nicely around, excuse me, this building. If we just press M to turn the mask off again and M to turn the mask back on, we can go over here. We can see it's masked very nicely around that building. So what I can do now is go to the curve tool here, and now we can really boost up our sky without killing my shadows in that building and so on. It's affected a bit. If we turn off this layer, then we're affecting the building on the right-hand side, but it actually doesn't bother me too much at all. What I could do, I could take my erase brush over here, erase mask, and we could erase some of the mask on that building, but as I said, it's not bothering me what it's doing. So we've added quite a bit of drama to our sky. We could also drop the we could also drop the exposure down a touch if we wanted to. Maybe we might think about adding some clarity, but it tends to halo a bit around the buildings then. So we're not gonna add that. So that's a good start. So the next obvious thing to do would be to say, enable black and white like so. So now we've got our black and white. Contrast wise, in general, if we just make sure I'm on the background layer, I might want just a little bit more contrast in general. Like so. A little bit more contrast. Now, my issue now is that building in the middle is a bit too light. I don't want to drop the exposure overall because I think it's going to make everything too dark, especially the sky, which is working nicely. This building I'm happy with. This building I'm happy with. This one's a bit on the bright side. So what we can do for masking this one, as it's a nice polygonal object, another way of saying square, we can actually mask around it with straight edges, which is quite easily as well. I wonder what the middle building was called. Michael says it's the IBM building. I know this one is the Marina, and this one is unmistakably Mr. Trump's, but I didn't know what this one was, so thanks for clearing that up for me. So we're going to take a small brush, relatively hard, like so, and we're going to just make a small dot in the top left-hand corner. Again, if we press M on the keyboard, you can see that. Oh, I want a new layer first, sorry. I don't want to edit that one. New layer first, call this middle tower IBM. Now we know what it is. And we're going to do a small dot here. We press M on the keyboard so you can see that once more, like so. We're going to hold down our shift key and we're going to click once. And what that'll do, it'll do a nice straight line across there. Actually, it was a bit wonky. Let's do that again. Hold down the shift key, straight line across the top. Let's scroll down to the bottom of the building, hold my shift key down, click once. That'll do a nice line down the edge. Hold my shift key once more and draw there, like so. Now we're going to scroll back up to the top, hold my shift key, click once more. And now if we do Command 0 to fit screen, we've drawn around the edge. Now we're just going to fill that in, say fill mask, and that fills that middle building in quite nicely. If you missed that, that's up here. Fill mask, invert mask, and copy mask. Three very handy things for local adjustments. So let's turn that off. And now all I wanted to do is just make that a bit darker. Make IBM a bit more black. Let's see. I've just overpainted a little bit there. So if I press E for erase, then I can just nibble away there so it's not obvious what's happened. So we can just clean that up a bit. So that means I can just darken off IBM a bit, maybe add a bit more contrast too. So if we turn that off, then you see that's before. Turn that layer back on, that's after. I think it just balances a bit better overall. So we're nearly finished, but we could do a little bit of dodging and burning. If you're old enough as me to remember the dark room, then we could do lots of selective dodging and burning by playing with the light and enlarger, cutting holes in pieces of card, wasting tons of paper, and costing lots of money. Much easier to do it now, fortunately. My preferred method, your methods might vary, but this is how I do it. We make a new layer and we call that selective darken, for example. Straight away before doing anything, I drop exposure down sort of 1.5 stops pretty much. Choose my draw mask brush. I'm going to go relatively big and soft. And the important thing here is changing opacity and flow. Now, opacity at 100% means that I will have a 1.6 stop darkening effect wherever I brush. That's probably going to be too much. So you might argue, well, why don't I just make this less? But I'm going to have a little bit of flexibility at the end, which you'll see. So I'm going to drop opacity down to something like 35 and then flow down to something like 10. Flow is a movement based adjustment. So setting opacity to 34 means that I will never go above 35% on my adjustment of exposure here. Now, if flow is at 100%, as soon as I move the brush over the image, I would instantly get to 34%. By turning flow down, this means I can gradually build up my mask. So if you imagine you're standing at home painting a wall and you have a very, very dry paintbrush, as you move your brush back and forth, it takes longer to build up paint on the wall. If you have a very wet paintbrush, as soon as you drag that paintbrush across the wall, you're at full paint opacity. So if I go down nice and low, and we want to do some selective darkening, so if I want to brush along here, see that's happening quite quickly. That's too much. So Command Z to undo that. And I can either drop flow down a bit and opacity as well, and I could probably raise this up a bit, and let's try again. So now that's a bit more subtle. Now if I keep brushing back and forth over the same area, it's going to build up more and more. So if we wanted a bit more darkness up in the sky around here, we could do so. But again, if that's building up too much, Command Z, let's just drop the opacity down a bit more, maybe bring that up a bit more, and then we can be quite subtle. So now I can just selectively darken quite nicely. I'm moving the brush fast, which you probably can't see on the webinar transmission itself. If this is too hot, I think I might darken down the edge of the building there. So back and forth, back and forth. I like the highlight running down the middle, but if we want to accentuate that a bit more, we could just darken either side of it and just bleed that off a little bit into that corner. This building's probably all right. I might just emphasize that shadow a bit more, like so, maybe just kill off that highlight down the bottom, which is a bit distracting, but there could be another way to do that. Let's turn that off. So that's before and then after. Now, of course, if I want to moderate that, I could just play around with the exposure a bit more. So by sort of having quite a big depth on the exposure, a low opacity, a low flow, it just gives us a bit of flexibility for changing. Now, if you wanted to do the same thing with lightening, I probably wouldn't in this case, but we would say plus and just call that selective lighten. We go this way with exposure, 1.5, same principle, nice low opacity, nice low flow. Let's make my brush a bit smaller. Then if I wanted to brighten my building highlight here, we could just do that kind of stuff. Would I lighten anything else? Maybe would we do a little bright spot on the front? Don't know. Maybe, but you get the idea. So if we turn selective lighting on and off, so just that edge of the building's a bit brighter. Last thing I might do, as I said, I thought it was a bit distracting down here, make a grad filter. Choose gradient mask. We're going to do a long slow draw up from the right and then just take that exposure down a bit in general, like so. So it's come on quite a long way. Let's bring up the color for Terrence, new variant. Hide the browser, Command B, hide the tools. So it looks pretty boring as color, but it actually looks quite nice as black and white. Loads of depth in the raw file. This is not shot with a Phase 1, it was shot with a Sony, but to be honest, any modern camera with good raw data, it's amazing what you can pull out of the file, to be honest, as well. So quite different from color to a black and white, and I think suits the subject well. What we might do is add a bit of grain. So let's zoom into 100%, pick a spot like that. And grain, again, is in our black and white tool tab, if you've added that. It's also in the details tab, which is this one, film grain. But let's stick to our black and white tab. So film grain, we shall have a look at that. Before we do, let's just check questions. You're right, clarity does halo much less than previous versions. It really does. I just find that with a blue sky adjacent to a building, you can still get haloing. So I think in this case, clarity isn't really needed. The only thing where it might look good, if we take IBM and put some clarity into that, then it just accentuates our windows a bit more. But yeah, I think I'd probably leave it at that. If I do it on the background and add clarity now, then yeah, we can, well, maybe it works, but we can see a bit of haloing around the building. I will add some structure, definitely, which will just basically bring out that architecture detail, especially for printing. That will look super, super sharp now. What were we talking about? Film grain and questions. Sorry. Yes, Elliot, we'll look at creating mask from a color editor. Where's the phase one building? It doesn't look nearly as dramatic as these. That's for sure. Is the auto mask better here? Maybe. I think it would be slower. It's much faster normally to create the mask from the color edit. And yes, I've got some of the building here as part of that mask, but in actual fact, it helped in this case. It wasn't a hindrance. There is no blur tool, Ross is asking. You can do negative clarity and structure, which works that way. You can see a list of keyboard shortcuts by going to keyboard shortcut summary in the help menu. Don't forget you can, there it is. Don't forget you can create your own keyboard shortcuts by going here. So they are not set in stone, the Capture One shortcuts. So Craig says, will 34% opacity of a 1.6 drop in exposure, so about a third of a stop max? Yes. So you could say, well, why don't I just do a third of a stop? Because I think if you have a deeper change in the exposure with a lower opacity, if that change then wasn't enough, you could drag the slider down more, you could bump up the opacity a bit, and so on. It just means that nothing is set in stone. Is there another way to dodge and burn? Nope, not really, but I think that's the best way. Certainly gives you the most finite control over that. I see some pixelation in the buildings and the background sky. Is it for because of the webinar video? Yeah, it looks pretty clean here. Yeah, it's pretty clean. I know that on the webinar broadcast they do compress it a little bit, so you might see like some posterization and so on, but it's actually very clean. I don't know what ISO this is. It is ISO 100, so I wouldn't expect it there to be much noise. If you compress blue a lot, then you might see a little increase in noise. But what we could do in that case, as we've got a nice layer of just our sky, what you could do is just increase the noise reduction a little bit more. So this layer here is just the sky. As we've crushed the blue quite hard, we could bump up our luminance noise reduction a bit more, and that would just soften it off slightly. But as I said, it looks pretty much noise-free on this shot. Roger loves it. That's good. Where were we? Film grain. Right. That was a long way to get to film grain as such. Film grain works in a very simple way. Let's just zoom in a little bit. Not that much. Maybe that much. Let's go to 100%. So in between Marina City and IBM. Five different types of film grain. Fine grain is like a legacy grain control from Capture One 7, I think. So it will add a fine grain over the whole image, but it's not intelligent like the other five modes. I say that because most applications that add grain to an image overlay some kind of scan that's been made from film stock. This is not what Capture One does, basically because that doesn't give you a photo realistic way of how grain works. The grain pattern and structure and density and so on will vary based on the underlying image, whether it's a shadow, midtone, or highlight, for example. So these are mathematical models of different grain types that vary their structure and density and all kinds of things based on the image underneath. You have two sliders, impact and granularity. So impact is a bit like opacity. So the higher the impact, the more visible the grain will be. Granularity or graininess, of another word, is how grainy it's going to be. So the impact is, like I say, an opacity. Why we didn't call it opacity, I'm not really sure. I remember many discussions about that. So by just balancing these two, you can get really nice photorealistic grain on your image. There's various different types, which you can just try to yourself. I don't have one particular favorite. I think every image looks better with various different kinds of grain. See, I think that's too grainy for this image. Harsh grain tends to be a bit harsh. So silver rich or soft, I tend to go for as well, and that works nice. It doesn't have to be on a black and white image. It could, of course, be on a color image as well. So also with grain, no reason why we can't use it on a portrait too. So let's grab our lady here, for example. Let's go silver rich. Again, impact and granularity. Just a nice sort of subtle effect like that. But it's a really nice way to add grain. I think out of all the options you could use for adding grain, like plugins and all that kind of stuff, I don't think anything comes close to giving such a nice grain effect as this simple tool does. There are some presets again, which you can try, but I'm a good proponent or believer in simply moving the sliders until you find something that you personally like the look of. I did mention a bit about sort of doing some dodging and burning on portraits. So again, in this case, it would be a very similar thing. So we would add a layer. Let's call this selective darken. I think in this case, I'd probably call it a stop would be good. And then if we take our draw mask brush, so if we just wanted to contour the dark areas, get rid of that highlight a bit, again, probably pretty low opacity and flow. So if we just go over here like so, and again, if it's too harsh, just back the adjustments off a bit. Same thing applies, plus selective lighten. Go up a stop. Again, low opacity, low flow. And then if we just wanted to brighten this area a bit, there's a shadow here. We could probably take the guts out of that slightly. Then it's quite easy to do. Pretty subtle if I just zoom out a bit. If we turn off selective lighten, turn it back on. Selective darken. Selective darken's been a bit harsher by the looks of it. Probably a bit too harsh, maybe. So what we could do is just try and fill in the gaps, or we just brighten that up a little bit so it's not quite so hard. I think keep it subtle. If we just do an option click on the reset. So before, after, like so. So pretty easy to do, and you can get some nice effects. Oh, before we finish, color balance tool. This is a really quick demo just to give you an idea of what's possible. Let's go back here. Let's go to the color one. So I did mention, where's our color balance tool and exposure, using these in conjunction. So like, if you remember, we said you could do split toning in the black and white tool. In the color balance tool, you have control over shadows, midtones, and highlights. You can basically pick a hue that you want to have for the shadows, and then also a density as well. Density control you can also use quite nicely with black and whites too. So in color, obviously, we could pick our cold shadows, warm midtones, and so on. But for black and white, what works quite nicely is if you drop the exposure right down till we're almost monochrome, and now you can have quite nice, subtle effects with these. And you can get really lovely looks with low saturation, playing with the three color balance wheels. It's not black and white, of course, but it's something quite different. I mean, even down at, say, 95, we've barely got any color information across, but we can still influence the adjustments. That's something I find myself doing quite a lot, as opposed to full black and whites. So this slider on the right is the density. So if we just wanted to brighten up highlights, we could do so using that. Midtones, we could play with that. Shadows, we can play with that. So just something else to arm yourself with for other than color, not quite color, not quite black and white, but somewhere in between. So color balance and low saturation works nicely. What you can do, don't forget, is if you drag these two tools out, you can stick them together. If we do Command T to hide the tools, then you've got kind of a nice alternative layout for working like so. One last thing I didn't mention was that to get to the presets quicker, rather than having to go to tool tabs, if you right click and say customize toolbar, look for the one that looks like this, styles. So hang on, over here, styles. Drag that onto the toolbar. And now this gives you access to all the various built-in styles and so on and so forth, like so. Whoa, inverse. Oh, someone asked how to invert a negative. I did say that. So if you want to invert a negative, you could do that. And hang on, get it right in a minute. Basically switch the top sliders, wasn't it? Or was it the bottom sliders? I can't remember. We did do a blog post on it a while ago. There we go. Switch your bottom sliders on the levels tool. Funny little workaround. So if you've got a negative or you want to create a negative for some strange reason, flip the sliders in the levels tool. So just drag them to opposite ends and you will create yourself a negative of the image like so. So if you photograph some negatives, color or black and white, just flip the levels tool and then you can get yourself a negative like so. There we go. Okay, last little look at questions, then we will have to see. Can you lower the opacity of an adjustment layer? No, there is. I know it would be nice. You can't have individual control over the layers. It's only the brush itself. But if, for example, you had, let's see. So this is an exposure correction. Changing the exposure here would be the same as changing the opacity on the layer itself. So it's kind of analogous to that. The reason why you can't do a lot of things like you can in Photoshop with different blending modes and things like that is that we're working on raw data. The maths get very complicated through the various different levels of layers. If you imagine in this example, we've got, where is it? In this particular example, we've got a couple of heel layers going on in the background. So getting rid of this dirty mark here. So if you think every time I change exposure, we're actually recalculating the heel option that needs to happen as well. So this can get very mathematically intensive, especially if you think we're working with 100 megapixels. There's a limit to what you can do with the raw data, basically. But 16 layers, lots of the various different tools, more than that can be used in Capture One 8 and Capture One 7, for example. Capture One 7, you could only do 6 layers, I think. So we're being improving it, and mask drawing is much faster in version 9, but there's still a limit. Could I use a curve for that? You can use curves as a local adjustment for inverting an image. Probably. I don't think so. No, we can't flip it in. Oh, maybe we can do that. There we go. Yes. Yes, you can. So you could flip your curves as well. Like so. So I guess you could moderate exactly how far you wanted to go with that. But yes, yeah, like that, for example. So yes, use the curves or use the levels. Good suggestion. That was Johannes. Faster computer we need. That's definitely what we need. Last question from Tommy. Do we have a tutorial that describes each components of each tool? We're getting there. If we just go to our YouTube channel for a second. So we've got these Capture One Pro 9 tutorials, which I'm slowly working my way adding to. If you look in the description here of Capture One Pro 9 tutorials, this link comes in the follow-up email, by the way. There's also this playlist, which is the Capture One 8 list of tutorials. So a lot of stuff in 8 is still relevant in 9, like if you wanted to convert an image to black and white, you could watch this one, and it's pretty much still relevant to version 9, at least the basics. So as I said, don't forget, you've got the Capture One 9 tutorials in the description. You can actually go back to the Capture One 8 tutorials. There's also the webinar archive, which you're going to get a list to as well. And there is help, phase1.com as well, which in a written way lists all the tools too. If you want a manual, a book as such, if you go to Amazon and search for Capture. No, actually, I won't show you Amazon. I'll show you the publisher, because that's, if you go to Rocky Nook, which is a publishing house, there's a free guide to making the switch for those of you who are on Lightroom and Aperture. And there is also a complete Capture One book as well. So if you search here, Capture One, like so, when it catches up, then this book here, Capture One 09. It's not in print until, well, very soon, actually, a few weeks, but you can buy it on Amazon as a Kindle edition, and they do have an ebook as well that you can buy here as well. So if you want a manual, that's a good place to start. So that's Thomas. Okay, unfortunately, that comes to the end of our time. I'll just show you what's happening next week, which is more specific to some of you. So that's for Capture One Express 9 for Sony. For any of you who are using Sony cameras exclusively, there is a free version for Sony. So if you know anyone with a Sony camera, do tell them about next week. So we'll be looking at the free version and also the pro version as well. When you leave the webinar, you'll be asked to fill in a survey. If you could, that would help us enormously to find out what you think and what you'd like to see in the future. So that will pop up when you exit, or you can answer it in the follow-up email as well. So many thanks for your time. Hope to see you all again soon, and take care.